Okay, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of Porkins Policy Radio. As always, I am your host, Pierce Redmond, and you can find this podcast and all the other podcasts by going to porkinspolicyreview.wordpress.com. And if you are a new listener, then I really encourage you to go through the archives and check out past episodes, great guests and great reports, and there's a whole lot there. But anyway, let's get to the episode. This is episode 27, and today we have the great pleasure of being joined once again by two of our favorite guests, Tom Secker and John Ryman. And we, the three of us recently spoke a few episodes ago about John's film, what is the name of your film now that I'm forgetting it? And
you know what? It's just White Widow, but
yeah,
I think...
Okay.
When I was making it, I kind of subtitled it, so, you know, there's a little bit of confusion there, but yeah, it's White Widow.
Okay, great. Well, very unprofessional, but of
no,
me.
No.
But anyway, we spoke about that recently, and when we were off air, we were talking, and we were talking about a whole bunch of different things, but particularly focusing on this idea of the white female terrorist, which of course is what your film is about. It's about Samantha Lewthwaite. And we thought that maybe we could kind of expand on this because this is something that we see over and over again throughout films and movies and whatnot. And of course, female terrorists have sort of always existed. You know, as long as terrorism or armed struggles have existed, there is, of course, the assassin of Indian Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi was a woman, Tamil woman, suicide bomber. There are the Black Widows in Chechnya. And there is, of course, a very famous Jamalia Buhirid, who was in the FLN and was depicted in the Battle of Algiers. She was Jacques Vergé's wife. He's a famous lawyer. So this has always existed. But yet in pop culture and media, we are inundated over and over again by white female terrorists. This is something that just pops up over and over again. And Tom, we were talking in our emails about this, and you were talking about a couple of different films and movies in particular that have this sort of meme. So maybe you can kind of kickstart this whole conversation for us.
Okay. Well, you're right. I mean, female terrorists, including white female terrorists, are something that have existed for as long as terrorism has existed. In fact, if you go back to one of my favorite topics of conversation, the anarchists of the late 19th century, a lot of the even most militant people in these organizations were women. So I suppose they had quite progressive attitudes, if you like. When we were chatting about this, it did strike me that there is a meme there that's worth highlighting, or at least worth drawing out in a few movies. You watched Black Sunday
yes.
recently.
Yes.
Yeah, not very good film. One of the main characters in that, and one of the main two conspirators in that, is a white female Palestinian sort of... is it explained what type of Palestinian terrorist she is, whether she's on the sort of Marxist PLO side or the more Islamic, you know, Hamas side, if you like?
Yeah, I don't actually think they ever really... point that out. I mean, I guess I would assume she's sort of the more Marxist kind of... Well, I don't know. Maybe not, actually. I'm not really sure. They don't ever really make that clear in the movie. I just sort of assume she was the more sort of like, you know, PLO Marxist kind of a terrorist.
Yeah, sure. I was just wondering, you know, vis-a-vis our discussion on Samantha Lewthwaite.
Mm.
But as I remember that film, which is not brilliantly well, I think you're right. So we also have what else did I mention to you? Escape from New York at the start of this wonderful kind of dystopian pastiche. Escape from New York. A white female terrorist hijacks Air Force One and crashes it into Lower Manhattan, 9/11 style. And of course, at the climax of Black Sunday, there is a similar sort of suicide hijacking, but in almost in slow motion because they're in a blimp. Then, can you remind me of the other film?
I think we were talking about Network and
Homeland,
of course.
Yeah. In Network, you have this terrorist group who are a bunch of, I don't know, Marxist or anarchist, far left extremists in any case, who are running around causing all kinds of trouble. And they, Patty Hearst style, they kidnap some ambassador's daughter or some millionaire's daughter. And she is seen in this film footage, you know, wielding a machine gun and helping them rob banks and what have you. So around that period, the sort of late 70s and early 80s, that character does appear in several movies that are very interesting and unusual movies in their way. They are the sort of movies that, shall we say, are at the cutting edge of attitudes and ideas relative to most movies at the time. So I do think that's interesting. That's, I mean, where do you want to go with that?
Well, I guess I just, maybe, I was sort of, when I was looking through this, it was sort of one of those kind of chicken or the egg. Is the white female terrorist sort of, was this, you know, how much of this is a real thing, or how much of this is sort of, you know, through pop culture and whatnot, this has sort of been repeated so many times that then when you do get a white female terrorist, you're sort of like, oh, well, of course, duh. Like, there's always a white female terrorist somewhere. And I couldn't really tell, and it seemed that in a lot of these movies, they were really kind of picking on something that I wasn't really sure true, you know, in like the late, you know, 70s, like when Black Sunday came out, you know, how many white female terrorists that, you know, were trying to blow up the, you know, Super Bowl stadium to protest Israeli and American actions in Palestine. You know, I couldn't, it's just sort of one of those chicken or the egg kind of a things. And within all of these movies and whatnot, there are a couple themes that you see repeated over and over again. And, you know, we get the sort of rich, privileged woman, you know, Patty Hearst, of course, is the granddaughter of William Randolph Hearst and, you know, very wealthy. The same with, I mean, Samantha Lewthwaite, I guess, wasn't wealthy, but certainly was well off. We get this sort of use of sex. You know, there's something kind of sexy, or at least the media will try and portray that, especially in films. You know, there's no ugly white female terrorists. They're all fairly attractive, and they use sex constantly to manipulate and whatnot. There's the fear element, you know, how could this happen? How could we get a, you know, how could this, you know, typical white suburban woman decide to, you know, want to be a jihadi? They all generally have blonde hair in the movies. And there is, many times there is some sort of romance involved. And I find the romance interesting, and hopefully we'll pick up on this later, because it seems that in a lot of the real life examples of the white female terrorist, there is some sort of romantic element involved. But yeah, I mean, maybe we can just sort of talk about some of these themes and how we see them and perhaps what they mean in a broader sense. And John, maybe you want to pick up on this.
Oh yeah, sure. I mean, Tom was saying, you know, where do we go with this? And at the end of his summary, I think one reason perhaps why we do see these, this archetype, I guess, for lack of a better word, over and over again is, and this is just my opinion, of course, but I think that if you think about, I mean, obviously, I think most people will be aware by now kind of where we stand on some aspects of the war on terror and the manufactured war on terror. If you're going to manufacture fear as a kind of product, you've got to appeal to the female market, okay? And, you know, there's plenty of, you know, we've got plenty of people, terrorists that are male, and, you know, there's white males, and there's black males, and there's Chinese males. There's plenty to choose from. But if, you know, if you're trying to build kind of, build consensus through fear, then you do need to show that, yeah, this person that next to you, you know, is a possible terrorist, and your girlfriend's a possible terrorist because she's white and a female. So, hey, you know, that fits the profile. You know, you see what I'm trying to say?
It's, yeah.
There's not, you can't just have a society where, you know, we now have, we're told complete equality. You have to have the other side of the coin. You have to have the female perspective on it. And, you know, that, again, that's just my slant or my take on it. But that's kind of, that's where I'm coming from, really, on this.
Mm. Yeah, no, I think that's a fair point. And I think that, I wonder if that's why in many of these movies, they're kind of, they're always pretty and they're, yeah, I guess, generally kind of smart.
If you're talking about, modern media, there is a quite a large, I'm quite shocked about how many people do have the same opinion that there is no such thing as entertainment.
Mm.
And if you stop and just, think about that statement for a second, what I'm saying is everything that's put to you and everything that you view, including this probably program, because I'm on it and I certainly have an agenda, has got some form of, some form of angle or axe or, some sort of direction it's trying to push. And there's various different levels of that, from complete weaponization, i.e. pure propaganda, down to very subtle levels, which I know you guys have discussed in the past, which is pre-programming. And, I don't know exactly where I'm going with that, but, there is an element to all this that it's what we've been shown. I mean, not just, it's not just film. It's every form of media is all some, you've always got some form of potential weaponization in that. It's something I looked at in the last week, when we were sort of getting together for this chat. About the weaponization of media, because it's a conclusion that I've kind of come to, really. I don't want to come to that conclusion, but I'm not left with many options, because some of the current narratives are so ridiculous that they're obvious propaganda, they're war propaganda. And the problem is how much else that, how much is not so obvious that's some form of bizarre kind of programming. And I'm pretty sure, because I know you guys have looked at this, about kind of pre-programming, and there's no, I'm trying to work up sort of another 30 minutes on the subject of Fraser and 9/11, and I know what you guys are thinking, oh my God, but it's just the biggest example I've seen of potential pre-programming. It's just... everywhere you look, there's something 5 to 10 years, it's something that's been there for 5 to 10 years. There was a very, you'll probably be able to fill me in on this, Pierce, but there was a very, the program where basically it was some form of thing like CSI, I think it might be in a spin-off from CSI, but don't quote me on that. But it's very, very well known, and it came out, I think, in somewhere between 95 and 98. I think it was a series, and effectively it depicted terrorists hijacking a plane and flying it into buildings, as far as I'm aware.
Well, there's the Lone Wolf, not Lone Wolf, the Lone Gunman, which is a
spin-off. That's it. Yeah,
that's spin-off of the X-Files.
That's
that
one.
Literally predicts 9/11, and perhaps then we can kind of segue a little bit in, because I do wonder, how much of this is, the sort of real or imagined, how much of this is sort of deliberately portrayed, because in a lot of these movies that we see, they really mimic a lot of real life examples of white female terrorists. And of course, not necessarily to a T, but there are lots of elements that are just so eerily similar over and over again that you do kind of have to wonder, how much of this is deliberate. And Tom, maybe if you want to pick up a little bit on this, because I know, we've talked previously in the past about the show Homeland, which I don't think anyone at this point would doubt has some sort of backing or funding or whatnot from the CIA, and that of course depicts a white female terrorist, and she really fits into a lot of the same criteria. She's rich and privileged. She falls in love with a Saudi man. She is the one, and this is another theme in a lot of the white female terrorists, it's the white female terrorist who convinces someone else that they need to blow themselves up or, you know, fly a blimp into the Super Bowl as in Black Sunday. Or in Homeland, it is actually this white woman who convinces her Saudi lover that they need to become suicide bombers. So, Tom, maybe if you want to start us off there, but, I mean, how do you see this? I mean, because there's so many kind of cartoonish representations of white female terrorists in films, but then we get characters like Samantha Lewthwaite, who is very cartoonish to a degree.
Well, I mean, yeah, okay, you're right. With the Homeland character, you have something a little bit different than what you had in those films that we mentioned. In the late 70s, early 80s, all three of those characters were some kind of leftist radicals, right? They were some sort of anarchists or Marxists, something along those lines. Whereas very much in Homeland, which is, of course, a modern show set in a contemporary time, you have a character who is effectively what we're told Samantha Lewthwaite is. She is a white, middle-class Westerner who, for some reason, became herself, if you like, seduced by Islamism and jihadism, and is then used as a means of seduction, as a weapon of seduction, in order to manipulate others into whatever, into violence. And so, I suppose, rather than getting into these, sort of breaking down each of these memes and details and what have you, people can just go and watch the show. It's in the first season that this character has any significance. So I think the sort of more important thing about all this is kind of what you alluded to, is that we're being sold a cartoon here. We're being sold something that doesn't sort of have that much integrity or make that much sense. Or there's all kinds of things that you can pick apart about it. We did this with the Samantha Lewthwaite story. But you can also, you know, with these fictional characters, it's never really explained what their motivation is. It's never really explained what their philosophy and outlook on life is. We're just sort of supposed to accept that, oh, this is something that's out there that exists and therefore something that we should be afraid of. And so I think the, even beyond the way that they either predict forthcoming events or kind of codify and normalize past events, I think the even more interesting thing about weaponized fiction, weaponized culture, is that assault on people's sense of reality, is that people lose their sense of reality because they're being sold something unreal in a way that's persuasive and in a way that then, oh shit, the following week or the following month, the following year, you see it on the news and you start thinking all of this is real. And you stop being able to distinguish between real life and fiction. And once you've got people in that place, you can tell them pretty much anything. And there's not an awful lot they can do with it because they don't, you know, their cognitive faculties that would be able to fight back against this have been so worn down. So you see what I mean? That's why, in some ways, that's the more interesting conversation here, for me, anyway.
Yeah, and just to kind of you know, reiterate that again, this idea that we can't tell the difference necessarily between reality and fiction. Patty Hearst, after she was pardoned by Bill Clinton, made a little bit of a splash in Hollywood as an actress in several John Waters films. And for any of the listeners who, like myself, came of age in the 1990s, she was a guest star several times on the Nickelodeon show Pete and Pete, where she played the world's nicest mother. So again, this, you know, you see Patty Hearst, you know, robbing a bank with the Symbionese Liberation Army, and then, you know, a couple decades later, she's making, you know, movies where she sort of plays herself, but not really, and then, you know, she plays the world's nicest mother in a kids' TV show. So very strange, and this blending between these real life people and Hollywood and films and whatnot, of course, is, I think that is the more interesting thing here. And another character besides that, we've, you know, all talked about Samantha Lewthwaite, I think, a lot, and we've really kind of dissected that. But there is, of course, Colleen LaRose, who's better known as Jihad Jane. And she is a interesting character and someone that I think most people kind of brushed aside when the whole trial exploded and even in her sentencing, which was only a few years ago, no one really took the time to examine this case, examine what was going on. And like with Samantha Lewthwaite, and like with a lot of these other, you know, white, either be they white female terrorists or whomever that the government deems, oh, well, they're terrorists, of course. You know, this guy was going to, you know, blow up the whatever Christmas tree in Portland, or you know, Jihad Jane is alleged to have been involved in some plot to kill Lars Vilks, the Swedish cartoonist who depicted Muhammad. But when that happened, it was just sort of assumed, oh, well, of course, yeah, her name is Jihad Jane. She looks menacing in this picture, so she must be guilty. And when you start to break down who Jihad Jane is, again, you get romance involved. She was involved with several different men. She apparently got... she picked up a guy in Amsterdam who was Muslim, and that's what sparked her conversion, which, you know, on face value is just like, you know, I don't know. Usually when I pick someone up in a bar, I'm not, you know, I don't really convert to whatever their religion is. But
well, it is a bit odd considering that the religion you're supposed to be converting to is anti-alcohol.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's another theme with all the white female terrorists, is that they don't really seem to adhere very much to, at least nowadays, let's assume that white female terrorists, by and large, are supposed to be Muslim. They don't really adhere to Muslim practices. And I mean, Samantha Lewthwaite, obviously, is a great example of that. But she's romantically involved. There is a staged nature to her attack. And it very much fits into what the culture creators have created. And again, you kind of have to wonder what is going on here. How much of this is real and how much of this is imagined? And with the Jihad Jane, I mean, the whole case seems to have just sort of come out of nowhere and fits into all of these pieces. And now suddenly, it's real, you know, white female terrorists, white, you know, suburban women convert to Islam and they want to commit jihad against the, you know, America, and they need to kill, you know, cartoonists who create Muslim, you know, depict Muhammad. So, I mean, either of you want to pick up on this, and I mean, John, I know you were did a little bit of research into Jihad Jane, and what's your take on her?
Well, it's funny because this Jihad Jane thing, in a way, is, I wouldn't say it's almost as weird as Samantha Lewthwaite, and it very nearly made it into my film. I really should have included her into the movie because, as you were saying, we're now in the era, or as Tom was saying, we're in the era of the, you know, the Islamic radical now. We're not in a kind of bomb-throwing, extreme Marxist female terrorist mode. We're in Islamic terrorist mode now, and it's a funny thing because she definitely, all the information I can gather about her, which, believe it or not, isn't that much, she's severely mentally disturbed, and the reason she says that she's severely mentally disturbed, if you read the United Kingdom newspapers, the Daily Mail and the Guardian, well, both got very large presence online. They do actually have quite a lot of US readers. But if you, you know, this is where I'm getting this information from. If anyone's sort of, you know, saying, how do you know that? Well, it's widely known that her father repetitively raped her from the ages of about 7 to about 15. And things just kind of spiraled more and more out of control. From about 7 to 13, she apparently left home at 13 and, you know, just wandered off. She's not suburban material. She's more sort of, I guess, late 70s Detroit, which the only thing I know about late 70s Detroit is the MC5. So I'm presuming the place is pretty run down, the start of the economic sort of downturn. I wouldn't have imagined that they're cashed up, not with that kind of background. I mean, generally, it does happen, but it's more kind of a poverty-ridden phenomena. And, you know, if you want to take it to the next level, just to make this more interesting, she's definitely MK Ultra material. She fits. If, you know, I just personally happen to believe that the MK Ultra program is A, much larger than we were ever told it was, or we think it is, or whatever, and B, it's still running, and C, it's never going to stop, just like the war on terror. So I'm just, that's just my assumptions there. And I've got a feeling that I wouldn't be surprised if, you know, it's, she fits perfectly an MK Ultra victim. She comes from a poor background. She ends up in care at the age of 16. She leaves home at 13. So she's basically a child runaway. She's up to her eyeballs in drugs. That includes heroin and cocaine. So she takes an overdose, which is another pretty weird thing. So if I was trying to recruit, get hold of someone to do some propaganda work for me for a much needed war, I couldn't do much better than get my hands on Jihad Jane. She puts up, just like Samantha Lewthwaite, she's got an online presence. She puts up her name as Jihad Jane. I kind of question how much naughtiness she actually really did do. I've got a feeling she didn't do anything. Because really what she's been imprisoned for is a plot. So it's, you know, it's conspiracy to do something, kind of like Charles Manson. So she didn't actually do anything. Or she was, like you pointed out, trying to get hold of Lars, remind me of the second Bilks? Name. Thank Bilks? You. Who, of course, is the Swedish cartoonist responsible for the kind of 90s outrage about depicting Muhammad in an unflattering light, I guess. So she's out to kill him. She gets converted online. How that works, I don't really know. I suppose you have some sort of, I don't know, maybe we can try it later or something. That's a joke. You know, I don't know how that works in practice. You know, she's mailing people and, you know, then all of a sudden she's on a plane, just like these people do. And that's it, really. From there, she goes all over Europe. Not sure where the money comes from, once again, to do this. She's really spent the majority of her life in a sort of, an understatement would be, abusive relationships. It's hard to imagine her actually being able to organize anything. But that's the deal. And what shocked me about this, it's actually a lot more contemporary than we think. One of the people, there was quite a few people jailed with her because she's in Ireland. She's hanging around with other Irish Muslim terrorist radicals, all four of them. And all four of these people get busted, and they all, I think, if I'm not, I'm pretty sure on this actually, I think they all got extradited to the States. There's a 15-year-old who, now let me get this right, he was 15 when he was arrested. He just got sentenced this year.
Yeah.
Which amazed me. That was just like, I can't believe how long this is took, how long that's dragged out. I mean, how long, that's 2009, 5 years it's took for them to get this guy, imprison him, arrest him, and the story to come out. It's a long time. So that's the basic deal with Jihad Jane. I mean, we can go further into it and, you know, start talking about potential motives. I mean, what like, as Tom said, what's the motive here? What is it? You know, I don't think for a minute that she was actually going to go somehow and track this guy down, who probably was surrounded by about 20 Swedish, government-sponsored bodyguards, if not private. Who knows? But I highly doubt he's going to be sitting in, you know, the park by himself. Mm. So she's going to go with no military training, nothing, with, I guess, a box cutter, is going to go up to him and kill him. I just, you know, it's all nonsense.
Yeah, I kind of, the more I started looking into Jihad Jane, I saw her more as kind of the exception to the rule. Unlike Samantha Lewthwaite, she is poor. She comes from a horrible home. Unlike Samantha Lewthwaite, Jihad Jane is actually in jail. You know, Lewthwaite is God only knows where. And it seems, you know, it seems, but at the same time, it seems like she was sort of made an example of, and perhaps that's to kind of, you know, to kind of convince people, oh, no, this really is, this is like a real thing. This is actually going on. You know, look, look at Jihad Jane.
I mean, that's exactly what I think. I mean, it, the way that it came out and the timing of it was very much like the anthrax incident. Don't hear anything about the anthrax incident anymore, because it's already in your psyche. It's already, you know, well into your psyche. It's in there. You've forgotten about it. And everyone else probably listening to this has probably forgotten about it. But it's in there. So next time it happens, you'll be like, oh, yeah, an anthrax incident, of course. But the way that that came out at that particular moment was just perfect, just like the Jessica Lynch rescue, inverted commas. They're perfectly timed. They're timed for political reasons, probably solely for political reasons, and that's it.
Mm. Tom, what's how do you see Jihad Jane fitting in? This is something we haven't really spoken of previously, but of course she is a white female terrorist, and we have talked about multiple times about this. You know, the Swedish cartoonists and so many of the characters that sort of run in the same circles that wanted to kill these Swedish cartoonists, or there was a Danish newspaper, they all seem to have some sort of state sponsorship of their actions. So how do you see Jihad Jane fitting in the picture of the white female terrorist, but perhaps also more broadly speaking?
Well, I mean, I was interested in what you were saying, John, because I honestly haven't looked into this case in a huge amount of detail. I remember this happening at the time and thinking there's something rather suspicious about this. But you're right, it's one of those that's kind of dragged on a long time, and so you just get this sporadic coverage of the story and you have to kind of piece it together like you have. But yeah, she completely fits into the profile of the kind of person that a security service, we would assume the CIA, would get their hooks into, would be able to quite easily manipulate, because she's, you know, vulnerable and emotionally half destroyed herself because of, you know, her upbringing and her life. So this is someone that they love people like this. She sort of reminds me a bit of Richard Reed. Remember Richard Reed, the shoe bomber, the guy who was supposedly going to blow up a plane with his shoes? Yeah. just, you know, a piece of, you know, a sort of half-wrecked human being. You know what I'm saying? I'm not trying to be sympathetic, if anything. I'm trying to be the opposite. But someone who doesn't have the defense against that kind of manipulation. So they, of course, she would be a prime candidate for that. And then you set against that the sort of, I suppose, initially the mass media coverage of this, set against what has she actually done? Not an awful lot. I mean, you called her a terrorist, BS, but I'm sure you were saying that in inverted commas.
Oh, yeah. oh, she's done nothing, really.
Well, nothing of any great consequence.
No.
She is a terrorist of absolutely no consequence.
Well, she's done nothing probably worse than what we're doing right now.
Yeah.
No. Exactly.
Yeah, she probably went to Ireland, had a lot of weird conversations with other sympathetic souls, and got online a lot, and that's it. As far as I can make out, that's all she did. Oh, and bum around Europe. But, you know, it's like she didn't actually do anything.
Mm. Yeah. She didn't buy any weapons or any explosives.
No. I know, it's crazy. There's no, like, you know, bomb making materials or, you know, forensics. There's nothing.
Well, no real evidence of a conspiracy beyond a conversation. And having conversations doesn't really amount to a conspiracy, I think. I think someone should have to actually, you know, come up with some kind of plan and start securing equipment and things, you know. Then you might actually have some evidence of a conspiracy. Okay, fair enough. If you catch a bunch of guys with revolvers and a map of how to get to the bank, then yeah, maybe you've got a conspiracy charge. But they don't even have that much in this case. So you really have to wonder, is this just a thought crime in the most literal sense of that word? And an awful lot of these I mean, this whole Danish newspaper thing would take a long time to get into and explain all the background of, but it is one of those gifts that keeps on giving in the war on terror. It is something where they love linking people. Oh, they were going to be involved in the Danish newspaper plot, or they were, you know, going to take revenge against one of the cartoonists who made these cartoons of Muhammad. And the most obvious one to my mind is this guy Tahawa Rana, who was a close friend of David Headley, who one of the world's most obvious CIA sponsored terrorists. Everything about David Headley screams CIA, you know. So, yeah, you've got to assume that Jihad Jane was part of that same, I don't know, conveyor belt for the war on terror. Mm. You need that conveyor belt. You need to keep rolling off those people who are, you know, these are the jihadists, these are the enemies, these are the terrorists, these are the people you've got to worry about. And every once in a while, they're going to throw in a you know, single white female.
And I think also the, just to... a little bit more on the whole cartoon thing. I think that, you know, was such a... the whole thing was so overblown and was so orchestrated by the media. And, you know, now it's like any time there is a depiction of Muhammad, be it on, you know, on paper or in a movie, they can use that to kind of, you know, push aside any sort of doubts about what's going on. And you can look no further than whatever the hell happened in Benghazi, and there certainly is a conspiracy to cover up what was really going on there, all stems back to some movie that no one in Libya even ever saw, where Muhammad was depicted. So I think it's interesting that Jihad Jane is connected with this, and that she is sort of seen as the poster child for, you know, white female terrorists in America, and she's connected with, I mean, just the whole, all of this, these cartoon, you know, assassinations are just so ridiculous, and you whip up this fervor amongst a certain, you know, minority of Muslims, and suddenly you can just kind of convince anybody of anything, you know, and it's a great way to, you know, kind of push self-censorship and a whole lot of other things. So, yeah, you know, I think it's interesting that she's a part of that, and that we see so many, you know, governments kind of using that to push a particular narrative, you know, to, you know, to basically be like, oh, well, if you show a depiction of Muhammad in a cartoon, you know, Muslims are so insane that they'll all, you know, want to come and blow you up. Really just ridiculous. And we've been talking a bit now about Europe, and it seems that this is kind of a little off topic, but it seems that, you know, all wannabe jihadis at some point have to go to Europe. And Tom, you live in the United Kingdom. John, you're in Portugal. And how do you see this? Because I just find this interesting that all of these terrorists, at some point, they're either in Germany or they're in Ireland in this case. I mean, I didn't really know there were that was a, you know, jihadi hub. But how do you guys see this? Because I think that also kind of encapsulates some of these white female terrorists a little bit. And we're constantly hearing, I think more so in Europe than in America, that, you know, when whatever the war in Syria comes to an end, we're suddenly going to see this influx of fighters who went to go fight in Syria, and they're going to come back to England and Spain and whatnot, and they're going to carry out, you know, these spectacular terrorist attacks. How do you guys really see this? How does this really fit into the whole narrative?
Well, all I can say is it's not, I wouldn't say it's just, you know, like Europe is some sort of way station for, you know, or rite of passage for terrorists. Obviously, you've got the geographical thing, you know, I mean, it's just geographically we're closer to where, pardon my language, but shit's hitting the fan. You know, it's what, 3 hours on a plane to kind of like the Middle East from England and Portugal. I do know that there's a large presence in Africa. So don't think, you know, there's, when I say presence, I mean, if I was a jihadi, say, I wouldn't be hanging around, you know, a relatively well-developed European country. I'm getting trained and I'm going abroad. That's what I'm doing. That's what they're all doing. That's what you're supposed to be doing. worst case scenario, you hang around in your own home country and you try something there. But that's like a second division sort of thing. Better to just join up into the brigades and go to Syria, where is the new fashionable destination. It was Kenya, it's now Syria. And I'm sure, tomorrow it will be somewhere else. It doesn't matter. But that's kind of my take on it. Don't think that there's some sort of, flag here that says all terrorists must register here. It's just sort of, it's like another thing, Piers. I've spent a lot of time in America, so I kind of got a, I can talk a little about Europe and a little bit about the States. You're going to stand out a lot more in most parts of America, talking any of this kind of talk or walking any of this kind of walk. You're gonna stand out. And wouldn't surprise me, first opening sort of years of the modern war on terror, you know what it was like, people ringing up, my neighbor goes to the local mosque, therefore he's a terrorist, goodbye. That sort of thing. This is my problem with people like these American manufactured terrorists. It's just, and English too, because there's not that much dissimilarity between our two societies. It's just really implausible, where this whole year, because you don't wake up one morning and just go, look, I fancy being a terrorist and I want to go to Syria and I want to kill as many infidels as I possibly can get my, possibly achieve. It doesn't work like that. It takes years and years and years, and so you're out there in public as this process is going on. You can't walk around, say, a small town America in full Islamic gear, spouting the Quran and saying how evil you think the American Empire is, because you're probably going to get I would imagine you're probably going to have someone come and pay you a visit. Don't quote me on that, but I would imagine, if you're in bumpoke Idaho, or some part of Texas or somewhere, it's just not plausible. Yeah, in New York, sure. I mean, there is, obviously, you got big metropolises like New York, Los Angeles. You might, yeah, okay, but they never come from New York or LA. They come from places like Portland. Now, I don't know. I think there's probably far more people wearing a hat of intelligence who are terrorists than genuine terrorists. I think they probably if they were all in a room, they'd be competing on trying to, actually get hold of the real terrorist, because there'd be like 99 operatives and one real terrorist. And I think that's what's happening. You've got a lot of this manufactured stuff coming out, and what are we getting back? Nothing. Genuine people. I'm not saying that that's something I think should happen, or we should be even fighting this war or anything like that. I'm just saying, Jihad Jane, what did they get back? A 15-year-old? Some 15-year-old? I mean, this is the end. This is the result that you've got from all of these years of work and your conversion. And your possible involvement with CIA or even darker forces. And what do we get back? A 15-year-old with problems. Great. I mean, what do we get back with Samantha Lewthwaite? Absolutely, as far as I can tell, nothing apart from a lot of bodies. I mean, it's just, I don't get it. I just don't get it. I don't get what their motives are either.
Yeah. Well, I mean, and Tom, feel free to jump in here, but it seems to me that the motives is just to create a big stir, to kind of focus the attention here, to make and we see, especially with the white female terrorists, that they pop up at these really great opportune moments, and we're seeing now with Samantha Lewthwaite. Tom, you sent me a couple links. She's what is it now? She's in Somalia again, and she married another guy. You know, and then there was another, some other white guy who was in Kenya orchestrating another attack. So it seems that they're basically, to a degree, I mean, very stage managed, and they are implanted in at certain moments, you know, in the media, and suddenly everybody is talking about them, and they kind of become the hit of the month. And, you know, and that to me seems to be their main purpose. And certainly with Jihad Jane, because, I mean, she kind of comes out of nowhere, doesn't really do anything. But yet, you know, we all know her name. You know, we've all seen the picture of her. And much like with Samantha Lewthwaite, no matter what, even if you kind of knew that Jihad Jane didn't really do anything, when you hear her name, you instantly are like, oh, right, that you know, crazy terrorist. Who, you know, yeah, she probably did something. The same way that Lewthwaite is kind of blamed for anything that goes on now, and people will just kind of instantly accept it. I don't know if you wanna touch on that at all, Tom.
Yeah, sure. I mean, with so many of these sorts of stories, you have to consider a good maybe 50% of them are just some kind of spook theater. It's a story that they've come up with in a back room somewhere and fed to the newspapers, and whether or not this has actually happened, they don't care. The newspapers don't care. They'll print it, and it will just be to either distract your attention from something else or to feed you a convenient idea at a convenient time in terms of keeping this war on terror narrative expanding and developing, because it does these days. It looks very different to how it looked in the immediate post 9/11 period. If you remember what they were talking about then, it was very much you know, it was very much Al-Qaeda. That was pretty much all they were talking about. Whereas now they're on about, oh, well, there's all these different sort of Al-Qaeda offshoots all over the place, and now we've got this ISIS thing going on in Iraq with these curiously well-funded and curiously well-equipped Islamic jihadis who seem to have come out of nowhere. And you see what I mean, that these things are always, they're to keep this thing continuously evolving. And to loop back to something that John said earlier, part of the point of the white female terrorist, right, is to make you think, oh, that, you know, that, I don't mean to use the cliches, but, you know, that soccer mom next door, oh, she could be a terrorist now. It's not just, you know, the bearded guy who runs that corner shop with that funny smelling back room that might be up to no good. You know, it could just be that woman next door who's driving the SUV. I mean, that's the mentality that they're trying to instill in us over time, is basically to, I suppose, suspect everyone and therefore destroy our relationships with everyone. Because that is the, I suppose, the ultimate weapon of the war on terror, is the war of terror, is to just scare everyone into kind of destroying what's left of society. Because, you know, if people are all isolated and alone and terrified of each other, they're absolutely perfect to just accept authority. Then you could have a openly fascistic authoritarian state and no one would do anything, because everyone's just bloody terrified of even uniting with their neighbor to try and fight back, because their neighbor might be a terrorist. So you see what I mean here? That's the mentality, and that's their sort of ultimate aim with all of this, I would imagine. So, yeah, I think that the white female terrorist in particular, it captures people's imagination, because it always comes with a picture, right? You can't have a white female terrorist without having their, you know, their Facebook pictures and their Twitter pictures and whatever on it. And so everyone sat there looking at these pictures in the same way as, I suppose, in the same way as people look at the pictures that get leaked from celebrities' phones when celebrities' phones have been hacked or stolen or something. It's that same sort of a story, isn't it, where you're sat there clicking through this gallery of pictures. You're consuming it in much the same kind of way. I'm thinking in the sort of Huffington Post style of presenting this sort of story. So what do you have here? It's quite voyeuristic in its way. And you're left with a conflicting feeling, because I do think that part of the sexuality of these images of white female terrorists is so that we are, to some extent, seduced by this. We're actually, I think, in a warped way, we're supposed to fancy these women. I mean, if you think of all those pictures you get of Samantha Lewthwaite, there isn't any in there that, I mean, they all look like the sort of pictures that girls post on Facebook to try and make themselves look pretty, which is in itself an odd thing for a supposed jihadist to be doing. But you take my point. So we're consuming this in a way that whereby we're actually almost seduced by these figures. Much like much like in Basic Instinct, where you have a not quite a white female terrorist, but not far off.
No, yeah, I totally agree. I think that's the other major and very important component to understand in the white female terrorist is this element of celebrity that seems to always be involved with them. And as you were saying, I mean, there's always, you know, there's always sort of sex involved, and we're kind of supposed to be, you know, on some level kind of attracted to them. There's even in the actual coverage of people like Lewthwaite or Jihad Jane. I mean, they read like gossip columns. And there's always this, where are they now? Who saw them there? And, you know, you could take a Daily Mail article and just take out, you know, Lewthwaite and add in Kim Kardashian, and I mean, it would read the same way. There's always what are they wearing and who are they with, and I find that to be really interesting, especially when, at least in the West, unfortunately, there is such a you know, worship of celebrity culture, and you know, I mean, people will really, you know, read the newspaper just to find out, you know, what celebrity did this and that. And I find that really interesting, that the white female terrorist has sort of become a celebrity in her own right. And again, they're more known for being famous, not for actually doing anything. The same way that, you know, Kim Kardashian is famous for being famous. There's nothing of substance behind anything that she's done. And that, I find that an interesting parallel when you look at characters like Jihad Jane or Samantha Lewthwaite, where they're basically famous for being famous. You know, Lewthwaite is famous because she's married to Jermaine Lindsay, which of course is a very, you know, that's how a lot of celebrities become famous, is being married to someone who's also famous. So, you know, I find that really to be the most bizarre and kind of creepy, weird aspect of all of this, because, you know, like you said, Tom, then suddenly, you know, you're looking at every picture online the same way that, you know, when some celebrity, you know, gets their phone hacked and suddenly, you know, every nude picture they ever sent is out on the internet. And you know, and regular people will be like, oh, well, you know, I wonder what they do look like. And, you know, you'll find yourself doing that. So I don't know if either of you want to pick up on that, because I find the whole celebrity angle of this is so bizarre, and I kind of wonder what that means. You know, how are we evolving as a society when, you know, we treat at least white female terrorists as some sort of, you know, celebrity sex idol?
Well, I mean, the answer to that is we're clearly not evolving, we're de-evolving. I mean, that's... Because we've come to a junction where we're, to be honest with you, quite a pretty scary place. Where, as Tom was saying, there's a disconnect now between a lot of people I know. I'm not going to talk about some fantasy people out there, or some statistics in the Daily Mail, or, you know, some other intangible. I'm going to talk about actually people I know, and there's a lot of people I know who have a real disconnect between issues of what the time that they should be wasting time effectively. You know, you're spending all this time on BS, you know, propaganda, BS, whatever, some sort of nasty kind of virus, who knows what it is, when you should be thinking about much more fundamental. You should be using that time, you know, that hour that you spent watching Celebrity Big Brother or Kim Kardashian or Samantha Lewthwaite, the CBS special, the hour that you've wasted of your life doing that, you know, should have been perhaps, you know, directed upon other things. And I just think this whole umbrella that we're talking about of kind of disinformation, implausibility, both of the, you know, people we've been talking about tonight, Lewthwaite, LaRose, totally implausible, but cartoonish. It's, you know, it seems to me that, like, you mentioned confusion. I think it's like a time thing, you know, like don't give them too much time to think about that, because we, you know, and it's that's the oldest one, you know, the oldest stories in the book. You know, it doesn't matter if you're in, I don't know, the time of Christ in Jerusalem or somewhere. You know, don't give them, you know, too much leeway and time to think about anything substantial, because they might actually start to question the whole edifice, you know, the whole thing about the whole media edifice that's now completely totally surrounds us. And like I said in the first 5 minutes, my opinion is it's always been weaponized, it is weaponized, and it will always stay weaponized. And it is a weapon. It's a weapon directed against you personally, me personally, and Tom personally, you know, directly at us. And it's very, very, very difficult to step out of any of this, you know, to take it into a broader sense, whether you're talking about believing in the war on terror and cartoon sort of white female terrorists, or whether you're talking about, you know, an anthrax plot that just so happens to originate in a US Army facility, whatever it is, you know, I just think that there's this, I guess just an overarching umbrella, and it's getting to this junction, this point where you've got half the people who have like, this is all bullshit, I'm not believing any of this anymore. And the fact, the more I look, the more bullshit, the more nonsense I uncover, and I don't like it, and it's pretty freaky. And then you've got the other 50% who are like, no, this is great. Just like put the Super Bowl on, pass the popcorn, and like put, you know, and let's watch the Jihad Jane special after the Super Bowl. You know, it's getting to a very, very, very interesting point for me. Obviously, the big thing that's the key thing for me personally, being a really old bastard that I am, being like nearly 50, is the rise of the internet and the rise of alternative media. Again, we've talked about, you know, this as RE, the war on terror, but I do definitely think that it is definitely has changed quite a large amount of people's attitudes to information, how they receive information, what they believe, you know, just so many huge things, huge, huge things, that it's definitely one good thing for us is the internet, because without which, A, this conversation is not possible, B, my film's not possible, C, Tom's film's not possible. You just go on and on from there. And it has really helped. I think it's definitely helped. And you've got to this point where there's an awful lot of people who don't watch the TV anymore, Pierce. They've turned it off. In Europe, the viewing figures for a lot of, part of it's economic. They can't be, they're like, oh, okay, I'll pay for the internet and that's it, and the cable can go and this can go, and I don't get to buy DVDs anymore because they went out of fashion like 2001. So you know what I mean? There's a lot of people. Yeah, there's a lot of people who, and I've looked, I'm quite boring when it comes to statistics. I've looked at stats on this, and you'd be amazed at under 30, under 35, they're not watching TV, and they're not reading newspapers, and they're not buying news journals. They are totally relying on the internet. And if you know, if you spend any decent amount of time on the net, you soon start moving around. You might start off on AOL in 1997 reading Time. Before you know it, you know, 8 years down, 10 years, 15 years down the road, you've looked and read it, you know, you've explored. And that, I think, is making a real impact. It is making an impact, because it's definitely made an impact on me, and I know it's made an impact on some other people.
Yeah, I mean, I hope so. At times, I tend to go down that path, and then other times, I just am so, I don't know, just not quite so positive that that's going to happen. And you know, I think with the kind of this new sort of celebrity everything, celebrity terrorists, celebrity whistleblowers like Snowden, you know, it's just a matter of time before we get some sort of, you know, terrorist reality show or something like that, or you know, we get some reformed terrorist you know, coming on and being a, you know, a CNN contributor or something like that.
Sure. There's the flip side to that. I mean, don't forget there's also the flip to that, which is there's only a matter of time before some insanely large smoking gun gets pulled out by someone, you know, who it's sympathetic, perhaps, you know, someone who was actually inside says, no, there was no body thrown over the side. It never happened. And I've got this, 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 and this, and this, and this. Basically, a Snowden times like 10. That's another possibility. And because, like I said, I mean, you've got that split 50-50, haven't you?
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I mean, I am encouraged more and more by lots of different people that are starting to come around to this. But we've obviously been talking for a while, and we've kind of gone all over the place with this conversation. So as we're wrapping up, is there anything either of you want to, you know, just point out or reiterate about white female terrorists, or perhaps, you know, more broadly speaking, some of the issues that we've been discussing here? Tom?
Well, sure. I mean, I think this is a very interesting conversation. We've actually made it much broader than I anticipated that it would be. And I mean that in a really, really good way, because it is. This is a example of this whole white female terrorist thing. It is the intersection of a whole series of different things. We're not just talking about, if you like, conventional weaponized fiction, you know, CIA or Department of Defense propaganda films, something like that. But like as we've touched on, it's also about this the weaving in of the celebrity culture, so that now it's very difficult to tell the difference if you don't have the contextual material. It's very difficult to tell the difference between a story about Samantha Lewthwaite and a story about Paris Hilton. And so you have this, it's a very curious intersection of a whole series of different things that is actually extremely powerful. And much more subtle, and I think much more important than I started out this conversation thinking it was. So yeah, I suppose all I'm really saying is I've enjoyed this, and you've actually both given me some material to think about that I hadn't reflected on already, I hadn't thought about already. So yeah, it's been good.
Excellent, John. Yeah. Anything you want to add?
Well, two things, actually. The first thing is, I'm a massive fan of Orwell. I mean, I just think he's probably one of the best political writers ever. Anyway, in 1984, when the book opens, and you know, Winston Smith is, you know, returning home, and it's all smelly and poverty-ridden, and it's exactly, from what I remember, the United Kingdom the last time I was in the United Kingdom was 2009, but to me, it was an exact representation of that. And what I was going to say is when he gets into his house, the walls are holographic, so you have continual propaganda news, effectively mixed with a little bit of entertainment, but you know, pummeled at you. You've got choppers outside with cameras checking, you know, that there's no strange activities going on, possibly monitoring your conversations for, you know, anything weirdly political. But the walls surrounded by these holographic TVs, and I just thought that's like a large flat screen 3D TV that he's got a few of. And you see what I mean? It like that. And the reason why this, you know, you've got this war now, because again, my opinion, weaponized media being the main weapon in this strange new psychological war, is because nobody's going to go fight a real war. Now, just do a straw poll of 100 of your, well, right, for my case, 10 friends, and do a straw poll and say, there's a major war outbreaks tomorrow. We're not really privy to all the reasons for it. Are you going to the front lines? Answer, 90% are going to say, no, I'm effing not. I'm getting the hell out of there. They're not going to, there's no way that they can use the old methodology of war as in a traditional sense. They've got a very new war that's much more subtle, much more effective, much more long-term, because it's never going to go away. and it's called a war. It's called now the War on Terror. I'm sure they'll change the name in the future, and it's been running for a very, 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 very long time, but it's now right in your faces. And it's in your faces because they can't fight. They can't get people like you, me, Tom. It's not 1914. We're not going to be running down the, oh, yes, please, sir, I want to die in the front lines, please. Oh, and we'll be, you know, completely obliterated by an atomic bomb. You know, it's just that those kind of conventional warfare is impossible now. Everyone's got the bomb. You know, what are they going to do? It's like the situation in Ukraine. It's never, you've got this continual propaganda, much, much more elevated to propaganda levels than you would have had, say, like even what before they had the bomb, like 1940s. They could have still got all of us to possibly go to Korea and possibly even go to Vietnam. It was getting a bit weird then. But now, forget it. There's no one going to go. So now they've got this alternative war. And what we've been talking about tonight is really some of the characters in the alternative war, which it doesn't exist and is complete theater and is a layer of the onion. It's very bizarre, but that's the society we live in.
Well, I think, as always, guys, we're probably going to have to return to this again and record another podcast because we've just, you know, right now going through my mind, I've got so many little things that I want to pick up on and dissect with you guys. But before we totally sign off, can both of you please tell the listeners where they can find your work? Your websites, you know, anything, films, books, all that sort of stuff. Because I just realized that I never really introduced you guys at the beginning of the podcast.
Well, okay, yeah. My websites are investigatingtheterror.com, spyculture.com, and humanity.net. I am on YouTube. I am not on Twitter, as previously discussed. So, yeah, check out those websites if you want more of my stuff.
Yeah, you can see my little film on YouTube. There's quite a lot of other stuff jumbled on the page because I don't know, it's just the way I do it. But the main film is up there on YouTube. If you just type in John Ryman, JonRyman, it's up there for all to view.
All right, well, guys, thank you so much for joining me on the show, and we will be talking again very soon, I hope.
All right, Pierce, thank you.
Okay, everybody, so that about does it for this episode of Porkins Policy Radio. I'd like to thank you all for listening to this episode, and if you enjoyed it, then please visit porkinspolicyreview.wordpress.com, and there you can find all of my podcasts, you can find all of my media appearances on other podcasts and different shows, as well as a lot more information. And if you do enjoy this, then please do follow me through the RSS feed, follow me through email blasts as well, which you can get on the website. Always follow me on Twitter, @PorkinsPolicy, and also do subscribe to my YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/1138Porkins. And I know that I sound like a broken record, but I really do appreciate everything that the listeners and the fans have been doing in promoting the show and in following me through YouTube or whatnot. It's really been fantastic and wonderful. And again, if you like this, then tell a friend, put it up on whatever social media you use, and please feel free to email me. And you can email me at porkinspolicy@gmail.com. And, you know, if you want to send me a line about how much you like the show or how much you dislike me, please feel free to. Well, anyway, I'm going to leave it there, and I will be talking to you very soon.